Thank you, Les. Thank you for being here, for all your support to our university, and your lecture today, and your training that's going to come tomorrow. I was wondering, what's your opinion about, is emotion process at the core of all human problems?
Yes. When I was younger, I was very involved with meaning as a young man, and I used to think it was too simple to say avoiding our emotions is the cause of problems. But I've really come to see that it's a central underlying problem, is how we deal with our emotions. It's not only avoiding it that's the problem, they're different kinds of problems. But I think it's a unifying underlying issue, so that basically our emotions are the basic datum of experience. And they underlie our healthy functioning, our unhealthy functioning, our relationships. So they're a very central aspect.
You've been talking about maladaptive emotion. How do you change these maladaptive emotions with another emotion?
Yes, I mean, this is it's a complicated idea to convey until you actually see it happening. But firstly, we tend to find in the outpatient therapies, not necessarily people who are severely disturbed or schizophrenic, but we tend to find that fear, shame, and the sadness of lonely abandonment tend to be maladaptive. They were adaptive in the original situation, but now in the current context, it's like you're reacting to the present with emotions from the past. So if your boss raises his voice, it brings up a memory of your abusive father, and you feel fear that's not appropriate. So now this emotion is maladaptive. So what we want to do is, I believe that these very deeply amygdala-based painful emotions can't be changed by reason. And you need to change them by having new emotional experiences. And there's a very interesting process, which is you have to first arrive at the painful emotion to feel it. So to feel the emotion, you have to feel the emotion. But then we want to not only arrive at it, but we also want to leave it. And when we leave it, we need to feel a new emotion. And like empowered anger or the sadness of grief can change. So if you feel shame, the tendency is to want to shrink into the ground. But if you feel anger, the action tendency is to want to puff up and thrust forward to protect your boundaries. So one emotion changes another emotion. So if we can help people in therapy in the context of an old emotion to feel a new emotion, it's going to change the emotion. And there's a theory now of reconsolidation memory, which shows you that when you have a memory now in the present, it doesn't just go back into memory again. It becomes labile or unfixed. And if you have a new experience in the present that's relevant to that memory, you're likely to re-remember the old memory and take in some of the present experience. So if you have a memory of an abusive father and you feel shame or fear, and then in therapy we can help you to stand up and be more assertive rather than shrink away in fear, then you're going to take into memory this feeling of standing up to him, and that's going to change your experience. So we have emotions changing emotions, and that's the theory of it. And often a way to help a new emotion emerge is to access a need in the old painful emotion. One of the examples I try to use as an analogy is, if you have a dagger sticking into you And if I help you to feel, you don't ignore it and you're not philosophizing, you feel the pain, and then I ask you what you need, your organism knows what it needs, and it says, I need the pain to stop, I need it to end. And once you know what you need, your emotional brain begins to evaluate whether you're getting what you need or not. And when it evaluates, I didn't get what I needed, I deserve to have a father who didn't beat me, you start to feel angry about it, or you start to feel sad that you didn't get what you want. So your emotional brain is working all the time, and it generates emotions. And it works by evaluating whether your needs have been met or not. So this is a process of how you change emotion with emotion.
Yeah, so as you know, we are starting here a master program in emotion-focused therapy here in Madrid and our university. And I was wondering, which is your advice to the, to those psychotherapists that are starting their training in terms of which skill is better to train before and which other one comes later in training?
Yeah, I'm not so sure we know about the sequence, but I would say first you have to be present. And this is not the same as meditation, because in Gestalt therapy, there was a tradition of Zen meditation. So that means being aware in the moment of inside and outside, and being aware when you're in your conceptual processing or thinking. Like right now, I'm aware of a dry mouth, and then I act on that awareness. So this is not the same as what's meant by mindfulness meditation, but it is, mindfulness is another name for awareness. So I think first you need to be aware and in the present, so therapeutic presence. Then empathic attunement to affect. And I like to say we keep our finger on the emotional pulse, right? And this is a moment by moment awareness. So these, I think, are the fundamental skills. But then you have to start training to be attentive to emotion. And the best way to do that is to be attentive to your own emotions. So I think you have to do experiential work, and also you have to learn that you can face or allow your own emotions and survive. So that helps you to be able to help other people to face painful emotions, because you're not too afraid. And then there's a sort of observational skill, I mean looking, seeing, and not thinking, but that's all part of presence in a way. But it's being attentive to breathing, to the vocal quality, to the facial expression, all the nonverbals. I think these are very basic skills.
And we are living exciting moments in for emotion-focused therapy community all around the world. Can you explain us what is the International Society for Emotion-Focused Therapy?
Well, we now have training centers in about 12 countries, and we're beginning to have a conference. So it seemed time to have some organization. Now, I myself am not very organizationally oriented, but one of the interesting narratives about client-centered therapy is Rogers was very opposed to having a Rogers Society. And so one was never formed in America, but in Germany they formed a Rogerian organization. Client-centered therapy is much stronger in Germany than it is in North America, right? And so organizations produce structure and change. So it seemed important to have an organization for networking. We have around 60 people involved as trainers, and they get together at a conference. And the website is a way of beginning, I mean, especially in the new digital age, you have to have a website, right? But it's to facilitate networking, communication, and the promotion of interest in emotion, but also curiosity and investigation of emotional processes.
Well, thank you so much, Les, for being here, and it's a privilege to talk with you. See you soon, hopefully.